Yay! I'm so happy to be here, and thanks for having me. I don't have any slides. I'm just going to tell stories. So, my name is Sandee Kastrul, and I'm the president and co-founder of i.c.stars. How many people have heard about i.c.stars? Awesome! That's great. You have no idea how good that feels as a founder to see hands. So I thought I would share the story of how I came to be standing here today. So I woke up and there was crazy snow. No, I'm kidding. Not. So this is the founder story. So I was a school teacher and I taught math and science. And I was, the first day of my chemistry class, I would pull down the periodic table and all of my students got to pick their element. And that's who they'd be for the whole semester. So if you were iron, I would call you Effie. If you were gold, I would say, AU! Thank you. Thank you. Okay, and then the next thing I'd say, okay, do you want to be a solid, a liquid, or a gas? Right, so all the cool guys would be like, solid, you know. And then some of the girls would be like, liquid. But the geeks, who were thinking, where's she going with this, would say gas. Now imagine you're 17 years old, and you've just declared in front of your colleagues that you want to be a gas. Right, you're gonna hear some sounds, right? And then this thing. So immediately, I would separate the room. The solids would sit in the front row. Their molecules were packed tightly together and they could not move. Sometimes I would talk to them as if they weren't as smart as everybody else because they were solids. And then I'd rope off a section of the classroom for the liquids, and I'd say, you know, you have a little more mobility because your molecules are spread out, but you will always take the shape of your container. And then, of course, the gases, because their molecules were spread out, had all the freedom in the world. So if I left the door open, they could leave. Now look, I don't care where you came from, but at 17, every kid wants freedom. So immediately, the solids would be like, well, that is not fair. And I'd say, well, then you have to change your state of matter. Or, like class mobility, we have to begin to change our state of mind. But at the end of the day, you can't forget who you are, what your element is. So for some of us, it's going to be easy. It's going to be about heating, cooling, or pressure. But for others, it's going to be much more difficult. You're going to be the one to give the answers. I'm just going to help you frame the question. And we would have so much fun. That was our journey. I mean, it was. I had the class where, you know, if they were giving a tour of the school, they would walk by my classroom very swiftly because it looked like absolute chaos, like our nuclear physics mosh pit, where we would chart the rate of decay of all of our close friends and family members, figure out who was unstable or radioactive. And so you'd be like, dude, you are unstable! Your isotopes are breaking down! Right? Like, but these were good times. Good times. So anyway, my rule is that I believe teachers are the last American heroes, and that if you haven't done it lately, you should take a teacher to lunch. Find a way to buy a teacher lunch. I also believe that one of the funny things about education is that we all believe we can do it because we're all users of education. And we don't really recognize the artistry in it. Anyway, so I had a rule, like, if you were in my chemistry class especially, you had to come back and take me to lunch after you graduated. And that science was the study of truth, and math was about our purpose. And so my science students, I would start the lunch by saying, so what is your truth? What are you doing with your science? And one of the most profoundly bright students that I'd ever taught, I mean, this kid could figure out cold fusion smart, like smart, 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 and not cold fusion like, you know, the late 90s WYSIWYG. Cold fusion, like the real cold fusion smart. So I say, what are you doing with your science? What's your truth? And he says, I'm working with chemicals. And I'm like, what are you doing? Are you smashing atoms? Like what? And he says, no. I'm working in cleaning services at one of the hotels downtown. And you'd be surprised at what people don't know about the basic properties of ammonia. And I was like, what? Like, here was this really brilliant kid. It was basically telling me he was cleaning toilets, and he was really cheerful about it. And I probably looked like I do now. I was like, and the more he was talking, the more I realized, because of his documentation status, he wasn't even making minimum wage. This was really messed up. And then he looks at me and he says, Sandee, you're not listening to me. You've always taught us that leadership is about making opportunities for others. And so it doesn't matter whether I'm in a lab coat or a lecture hall or cleaning toilets. I'm teaching just like you taught us. And I was like, damn. So earlier that week, I was giving a lecture to a room full of teachers, like hundreds of teachers. And it was one of those lectures, you know, when you're giving a talk and you know you're just like on fire, right? Like the people are like, yeah, and you're like, yeah, and they're like, yeah. And so the whole talk was about this notion of every lesson we teach is one we need to learn. And until there's reciprocity in education, until we're both teacher and student, we're only doing half of our jobs. And people are like, yes! And I'm like, yes! And then I like dropped the mic before it was even cool to say drop the mic. And I did drop the mic. And days later, I'm sitting there at the Riccobini's, and I got taken to school. That Javier took me to school. And I knew that day as I was walking down Wabash Avenue that my life would never be the same. That I was going to go from a career that I was very good at, that I was super comfortable, that I loved, to the unknown. I would have a huge learning curve. And I didn't know what it was yet, but I knew it was going to change everything. And that was the day that the other founder and I kind of founded i.c.stars. So we love technology because it's creative. It doesn't really matter what you look like. It can be a meritocracy. And what's more, the systems thinking and the process and methodology that's embedded in technology makes for an awesome blueprint for community leadership. So the question was, what if we taught programming and development and got folks great jobs in IT, but use that blueprint to solve the problems that we face in our communities every day? The ultimate application. I mean, at the end of the day, technology is really about solving problems and building solutions. And we're so tired of waiting for other people to come in and solve our problems and build our solutions. So why can't we be the ones? So it was 1998. We spent about a year and a half of in R&D and went all around the country. There was this great program in Milwaukee that was teaching web development called Homeboys. And it was started by a Jesuit priest who's famous for saying, nothing stops a bullet like a job. And I love this guy. And so we went there to see it, and this model was absolutely brilliant. So he spent like, he spent his time walking the streets, finding people who were addicted to drugs, who were trying to get out of gangs, who really wanted to change their life. He would have them spend a year being baggers in a grocery store to sort of get their grounding and their footing and get rid of those things in their life that they wanted to. And then after a year, he would then take them in and teach them how to be web developers. And they lived in this house in Milwaukee. And when we walked up, the house was like kind of like a crazy house, like, you know, a little nutty and squeaky and funky and smelly. And outside of the house was this huge coffee can filled with cigarette butts. And Leslie and I were just kind of like, oh, how nice, you know. But the model was absolutely brilliant, because once we went inside the house, everybody who was in there was the owner of that house. And they were like, dude, let me show you what we're building. And dude, let me show you. Like, they had such pride about their work, about where they lived and what they were doing. And this father, he went and got work from all of the local businesses that kept them going. It was a social enterprise in 1999 doing technology training. We were like, that's it. So there's a lot happening on the West Coast around video production, a lot happening on the East Coast around like hardware and repair. But this Homeboys program was right. And it felt really good. And we were like, okay, we want to do something like that, but there's not going to be a coffee can with cigarette butts. We're going to do a project-based learning environment where we take on a project by a company, and we take our cohort, divide them up into teams. They form their own consulting companies, and they'll be competing for this RFP. And that was kind of the model. And in 2000, we launched the first IT boot camp. And it was a nonprofit. And 100% of our graduates went to go and work at dot-coms. And they rode around on scooters and ate Pop-Tarts all day and drank lots of coffee. And life was great. And we were like, we did it! We did it! And then the bubble just burst. But here's what was really cool. Remember the coffee can with the cigarette butts? Our answer to that, the girl power, and this was like when the Powerpuffs were girls were really hot. Like, we thought we were the Powerpuff girls. That's what we were going to, we were just going to like, we loved their round faces. We loved their fists in the air. And I was the one with the red hair, and I would just pencil in a little more color. Anyway, we named the server Mojo Jojo. It was terrible. That was such a mean thing to do. Can you imagine typing that over and over? Anyway, so our answer to the coffee can with the cigarette butts is that every day we would have high tea. And at 4 o'clock, everything would stop, and we'd sit around very civilized and have a pot of tea and invite a different business or community leader to the table to share their story over a pot of warm tea. That was our answer to the cigarette butt. Because remember, the cigarettes in the coffee can was where everybody like hung out and talked about stuff. And they're like, dude, how do you do while loop, right? Like, so how could we sort of take that, but like clean it up a little bit and make it more Powerpuff? And so we've had tea since day one, and we still have tea today. And it has been the most magical thing, because we saw the bubble burst before it happened because of tea. So we went from like normal people like Adam Heckman coming to tea and kind of talking about his career at Microsoft and, you know, normal things, to like crazy entrepreneurs who more and more their products or services didn't make any sense. And just to really give you a visual, one day this dude came and he had an entourage. Like for real, like an entourage. There were like four women who said nothing the whole time. And when tea was over, he went like this. Ladies. We knew that is the sign, my friends. Nothing good can come of that. So we were very fortunate to be able to pivot at that point and aligned with Fortune 500 companies and CIOs. And what the magic here was, there was an organization called SIM, the Society for Information Managers, and they really adopted us. Like, so we said to them, look, you know, we're a startup nonprofit. We do this boot camp. It's really intense. It's all project-based learning. And the only pause we do is for tea. It's 12 hours a day. You can't be late or absent or you're fired. It's workforce development. Adopt us. And they said, okay, we will. And so that circle of CIOs became our employers, became our tea speakers. And the reason why they loved it is they remember when they first came into IT. So they came from maybe finance or something. They came at a time when there weren't computer science degrees like there are today. That this boot camp was reminiscent of their days at GE or Continental Bank. And so they felt nostalgic. They believed in the model, and it was good. What's more is, CIOs, of course, are the buyers of technology, and we were able to leverage those relationships to build relationships with the sellers, the technology service providers. And that became our flywheel, and we became the biggest good to great junkies ever. So that 70% of our revenue came from our thought leadership events, where we'd bring together the CIOs, they would talk about what's coming down the pike, and then we would invite the sponsors, the technology service providers, to come and have a seat at the table and be a part of this network. And we became like the hottest ticket in town for technology events in that loop. What's more is that at every table that there was a CIO and a technology service provider, there would be one of our interns or alums. And they would be the joiner of hands. Because guess what? They had tea with everyone. And so they knew all of the technology executives. So if a vendor was kind of like, get out of my way, kid, I'm doing business here, rah, 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 that was it. They had the relationships with the CIOs. And just like making that shift from consumer to maker is power, so is joining hands and making introductions. When you stand between two people who then become friends, become colleagues, become associates, they'll never forget that you're the one that introduced them. So tea was magical, and what's more, it was our job to change perceptions on the other side of the table. So I could easily ask any executive in town to come and have tea at i.c.stars, spend an hour. Who wouldn't? Like, you'd have to be an asshole to say no. Right? Like, no, I'm too busy to have tea for an hour with the inner city youth in the future. Who would do that? So, right, so everybody says yes. But sometimes people show up and they think, yeah, I'm meeting the inner city youth today, and everybody's going to be wearing hoodies, and they're going to be like, yo, we cold, right? Like, or something like this. And instead, they leave the table saying, oh my gosh, they ask better questions than my management team. How do I get my team engaged? How do I support this organization? And how do I hire from IC Stars? So that was kind of our recipe for awesomeness. And up until 2008, we had 100% placement for our graduates. The average earning increase was 400% from the before the program to after the program, an 80% retention rate in the industry. And to date, we have over 40 homeowners in our alumni association. And that's a really important metric to us, because it's not that people are, you know, going from public assistance to being homeowners, like that's great. But what's really cool is that they're buying homes in the communities that they came from, even if that means they're going to commute 2 hours to go and work at Allstate. Because we asked the question, what if success wasn't getting out of the hood, it was investing back in? And so I said, to 2008, so like, again, things were good, and we were like, yay, we did it, we're so great. But then 2008, remember what happened, the second recession hit, and our employers were like, oh, Sandee, I mean, it used to be, I could call a CIO and say, I got this many programmers, this many analysts, this many QAs, you know, and everybody would be gone. And now they were saying, we can't grow headcount. Oh, and by the way, when we do hire again, it's going to have to go through HR. And you know, that's the kiss of death. The people who are laughing are in workforce development. and did I say something wrong? Was the okay, so... So, you know, the first rule in sales, they tell you, is in sales training, they say, okay, you put an offer on the table and then shut up. And the first person who talks loses. And that's really hard to do. And especially for me, because I could talk and talk. So, basically, I'm like, I got this many, and they're like, oh, I can't grow headcount, and I'm just like... And it felt like an hour, but it was like 2 minutes. And then a voice on the other end of the phone said, however, I do have some consulting budget and some projects. What if we gave you those projects, you managed them, hired your folks, and our social enterprise was born? So we started to do retained services, staff augmentation, and project work. And that's how we rode out the second recession and kind of how we're still alive today. Interestingly enough, we're scaling the organization and growing into new cities. And that's the draw for other cities, is that self-sustaining revenue and kind of put your money where your mouth is. And having that 2 years of doing a residency where you're doing project work and staff aug and working for IC Stars and having the safety of kind of being in the nest but actually being out, that's making the whole thing work. So there's magic in that too. But what I really wanted to talk to you guys about, like kind of last thing, is, you know, I've told you a great story. You guys are like, oh, I love that lady with the curly hair and the funny science teacher who went technology. And it's so great that, you know, all these kids are getting great jobs and buying houses. It's great. It's good. But really why we exist is to develop 1,000 community leaders by 2020. And so that's a really lofty, delightful, delicious goal. 1,000 community leaders by 2020. Well, good for you. What does that mean? So at the center, I think there's oppression. And it's really about a lack of opportunity. Like when your zip code determines your life expectancy, that's messed up. When your zip code determines whether or not you have access to great education, that's messed up. When your zip code determines how easy or hard it is to get into the economic mainstream, That's oppression. And they're all connected. It's a lack of opportunity. So when there's a lack of opportunity in our community, our ambition goes down. So we've all heard the, you know, my ancestors came here and they pulled themselves up by their bootstraps. They came with a hat and boots and all this, you know, and boots. And there's all this dude's boots. The truth of the matter is, there was opportunity. Whether you took an opportunity or you made an opportunity, there was an opportunity. When there is no opportunity, when the only opportunity in our communities are liquor stores and vacant lots. Do you know that if there's a vacant lot on the corner of your block, it's like a sign that says, vagrants welcome here. All we have given up on this block. It's like the cornerstone of the block has been deserted. Okay, so no opportunity, our ambition goes down. So why would I believe that there would be anything for me if I've never seen anybody who's done anything? I've never seen a software engineer. I've never seen a data scientist. What is that? And furthermore, it's exacerbated by really bad policy. And so, bad policies are made by people who come into our communities thinking that they're going to fix things and make things worse than they ever were. So like a really good example is all of the, you know, we're about to walk into an immigration, we're already in it, like shitstorm. Forgive my language, I hope the lights. Or the policies around ex-offenders. I mean, really bad things. And things that are happening all the time from a legislative perspective that are impacting real people in their houses, in their communities who are doing things. And so this cycle perpetuates. And so when we talk about community leaders, I'm thinking about three kinds. This is advocacy. Advocacy leaders who are impacting things from a systems level. Business leaders who are entrepreneurs or creating jobs and hiring people from the community. And then service leaders who are teaching and mentoring and doing things in the community and being visible and saying, I am here. I am a data scientist. And so our big what if was, what if we had about 333 leaders in each category and they all talk to each other and they all work together and that we could reverse this cycle to be a virtuous one? Well, I think that's kind of what you guys do in these meetings. So I want to thank you for letting me be here tonight and be a part of this really cool tribe where you bring your brilliance to solve problems that are impacting our communities through service, through business, and through advocacy. Thank you for claiming me.
All right, so who is first question?
I can bring
less of a question, more of a comment. I've been with Microsoft for about 25 years. I must have hired a dozen people into the organization. Easily the best decision I ever made was to hire somebody out of i.c.stars Cycle 2. The last time that person worked for me, his title was Chief Technology Architect. And that's because Sandy and crew beat the shit out of him every day, 12 hours a day for like 3 months, was it? excuse me. And yes, he has a house and two Audis and a family and all that. And so, Sandy, thank you for everything that you've done for my organization, for the city, and for me personally.
Thanks, Adam.
So what happened to the kid that went on to clean toilets?
I don't know. But thanks to the magic of Facebook, I feel like it's just a matter of time.
What cities are you expanding to?
Yeah, so we opened an office in Columbus this summer, Ohio, and then Milwaukee probably Q4 of this year.
How do you choose what students are in your program?
Yeah, great question. So, we'll see about 400 people to select the 20 who start in the cohort. So all of you who are here from like the nonprofit sector are like, oh, forget it, I'm not sending anyone over there. They're just going to get disappointed. It's not like that. It's not. So 380 people we're not saying no to. For the most part, they're self-selecting out, and they're saying, I'm not ready yet. So do send people. Because our process is we're learning designers, and so a lot of the tools we built in-house, so they don't have any bias in them other than the bias that if you are resilient and have overcome adversity, you're going to do really well on this test. So we look for aptitude for technology, of course, but we also look for attitude and motivation and drive and tenacity. So there's like one crazy test, I would never pass it. And we don't look for the right answer, we look for how many times did you take the test. So like the person who took like 100 times is gonna get in. And then we do our sort of classic doing it since day one is our resiliency interview. And it's a panel interview with staff and alums and such, and it's just 7 existential questions. And that's the whole interview. So can I tell you the first question? Okay, so the first question is, who's the man?
What?
Okay, so here's what's crazy. Like, the average 20-year-old says, I'm the man. And so they have to say, no, 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 who is the oppressor? Can you name him? Is the world fair? Well, what does the world look like when it is fair? As people of color, do you think we have equal opportunity today? 95% of people say yes. Do we need affirmative action? No. Even when you explain what legacy points are? No. So this kind of campaign has been digested in the inner city for deeply. And then when we really break it down, like, okay, so let's talk about it in terms of college. Like, our ancestors might not have been able to go to Yale, like the Bushes. But if your ancestors went there, you get the same amount of points as affirmative action points. Does that make affirmative action more fair? The answer is still no, because we don't need a handout. Damn. Right? Anyway, so all the way until like, so should white people be accepted into i.c.stars? And everybody just kind of looks around like, I know I saw some white people here somewhere. Of course white people should be accepted into IC Stars. So if you came here and everybody was white, would you feel like this program was for you? No. So should we have like a quota of white people? And they're like, oh. And that's the bird where it starts to unravel. So it's good. That's all one question of the seven.
Does anyone want to attempt to ask a question to follow that up?
Is there any time spent on soft skills after having all of the developing and coding to be able to be that workplace culture fit?
Yeah. So I didn't grow up in technology, and it was almost like every technology person that I met was kind of a jerk. And a jerk in this way of like, technology people, and I remember I was a school teacher. Like, we're the ultimate salespeople. We're like hawking subject matter every single day. So we are extroverted, we're dynamic, we're great storytellers, we can sell anything. So I'm like kind of in culture shock around technology people, because unlike education, where we're trying to figure out how to give knowledge, it felt to me like technology people were trying to figure out what you don't know and try to catch you in this loop of what you don't know. It was so bizarre, like kind of learning that cultural shift of complete opposite. So anyway, all this to say, there was no way we were not gonna teach soft skills. So the project-based environment is simulated in that it's scripted, but the software that they build is real. So for example, you know, the teams are competing and everything, and the second client meeting, they go out to meet with their client, and a fight will break out between the business and the IT folks on the client side. Like that ever happens, right? And so the teams are there to present, and so they've got to, in the moment, be like, okay, what do we do? Do we mediate? Do we moderate? Or just shut up and let the loudest person win? And our belief is that resilient people who have overcome adversity already have this resiliency toolkit, and we're just providing a context for them to unpack it. So they figure out in that moment how to be consultative and get everybody back on the same page. Otherwise, it gets crazy that people will storm out and yell. And then when the whole sprint is over, we do this like sunset review and then give a prize to the best actor, the Erica Kane Award, there's a tiara, all of this. But after the meeting, they go back to the whiteboard at IC Stars, and with their program director, she'll lead them through this process of, did you build trust and credibility with your client today? Did you defend your client? And then each team will sort of mark on the X, Y axis where they are in terms of trust and credibility. And there's a whole rubric to figure out where you are and where you want to go. So yes, absolutely, it's a third leadership skills where all the soft skills and professional skills sort of bubble up. And then, of course, business skills and technology, and it's about a third of each.
All right, I think we have time for one more question.
What do you need?
Yay, great question. So we need absolutely coaches, mentors. We do this great mentoring thing that's like The Voice, where we have three mentors at a time kind of turn their chairs, and then the people will do a pitch, and then if it resonates with you, you spin around, and then if two people spin around, then you have to duke it out to see who gets to mentor. So we're always looking for mentors. We're always looking for project sponsors, so get your company engaged. I'm also looking for entrepreneurs who are disruptors. So one of the things that I'm thinking of is our event model, disrupting it a little bit and having like, you know, nice conversation about big data, and then all of a sudden all these entrepreneurs kind of come in and disrupt it and talk about, you know, what's really going on, like what's, like that would be cool. But yes, and of course come to tea. And if you work on the community side, we'd love to talk with you more about referring candidates, about doing project work for you, and about how our interns and alums can be of service. So we're always looking for service projects. But yeah, I mean, just come hang out with us. We're lots of fun and there's lots of ways to plug in. All right.
Awesome, thanks so much.
Thank you.